Augie! Hold on, hold on.
Hello, everyone. My name is Augie Hurst.
And I'm Tom Wilson.
Together, we have the wonderful privilege of serving as the pastors here at Lebanon Presbyterian Church in Mercer, Pennsylvania. Thank you for tuning in today, Sunday, May 3rd, 2020.
It's the first Sunday of the month, and at Lebanon, that means we celebrate communion. That will be no different today, as our online service will provide a celebration of communion that you can partake in at home.
And since you are at home and we will be participating in celebrating the sacrament of communion together, I want to take this time to invite you to make any preparations that you might need to take communion this morning. First, feel free to pause the video at any time to make these preparations. Find a place in your home on whatever device that you are watching this video where you can sit and have a meal. Even a coffee table in your living room will be fine. Also, go into the kitchen and find any sort of bread product. No special type of bread is required. Even a cracker would be fine. And of course, juice, or since you're at home, even wine if you like. We're going to begin our service today with a scripture reading.
Our scripture today comes from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 11, and begins with the 23rd verse.
Hear now the word of the Lord.
I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread.
And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way also the cup, after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me."
For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again.
I love First Sundays. I love First Sundays of the month here at Lebanon. At this time, in the week, I would have already texted Lynette Beck, Kathy Mitch, Dana Lashon to make sure that the elements were prepared for communion. I would have texted the elders as part of my duties to see who would be at which service to assist with communion. The sanctuary would be a little more formalized, the table set with our gold plates. Marge Burgoon would be here to play the organ, and we would celebrate the Lord's Supper, the Eucharist. And we will today, just a little bit differently. And there's probably a little bit of trepidation, a little hesitation to doing communion this way, to gather together as we're gathered separately and at great distances. I hope that this message can reveal that what you're about to do in your homes is actually legitimized scripturally and maybe even perhaps a little more authentic. And so the scripture this morning that Pastor Augie and I read responsively are the familiar words inviting us to and directing us through communion. Paul didn't make this stuff up. He starts it as by saying, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you." He heard from folks who were firsthand rubbing elbows with Jesus himself. And then he learned this, and he's passing it on now to the church in Corinth, and eventually to us. John later writes in Scripture, he uses the words that we proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. John, a first-person witness to the ministry of Jesus, passing it on to us and drawing us into fellowship with not just him and other believers, but Jesus and the Father themselves. It's far more than just a meal, communion. It's a celebration of communing, of joining together, of coming together in a community. Joining together, as I said, Jesus Christ, his Father, and all of us, all the faithful believers now and even through the ages. Today, as we have communion, we commemorate the Last Supper. Jesus is gathering with the 12 on the night he was betrayed. And that was the first communion, a gathering of Jesus' loyal. The 12 communed with Jesus in that upper room. And later, after Pentecost, hints appear in Scripture that those meals commemorating that event continued. Acts 2 tells us this about the fellowship of the believers. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold their property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. And every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple area and to breaking bread in their homes. That suggests to me that the first Christians, those who either knew Jesus personally or who were convinced by Peter's preaching at Pentecost and afterwards, met in various homes to break bread and to deepen their faith. Breaking bread, by the way, is the oldest term used for celebrating the Eucharist. There were four features that I know in my studies that were in the early life of those believers. Koinonia, which is a fellowship, a gathering, a communion, a community of believers. Prayers, breaking bread, and teaching. And the early churches were home churches. Communities of believers that felt strongly they had much in common and went beyond just fellowship with themselves. Also was a spirit, and for us, a literal Holy Spirit that bound them together, that had been sent to them. And those who have fellowship with one another, those who share the same resources, also share the same responsibilities. And it's almost overwhelming when you think of those words of John, that you sit about the table and are in fellowship with not just each other, but with the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ, as well. And we all have these things in common. And so before missions and missionaries took the message of Jesus to the very ends of the earth and sought to replant those institutions elsewhere, it was all grown at home. It was in a home church with colleagues and friends who would remain in contact, supporting each other through trials, through tribulations, and like now, even through separations, for all of their lives and even beyond and through generations of people. The New Testament reveals many references to house churches. Family homes where early believers would gather and ponder the life and ministry of Jesus, grow in their own faith, support each other with prayer and Christian love. And what exists are those references to those home churches held together by fellowship, prayers, teaching, and breaking of bread. Nowhere is there in there a biblical mandate for a particular church building, a layout, that it had to look this way or that way, for fellowship halls or youth spaces or pastor's offices or vestibules of crosses or crucifixes to hang on the walls or pictures of Jesus or pulpits or hymnals or vestments or anything of the like. What is there is the mandate to gather. There's no mandate for much of what we do, but we often get caught up in what we do because it's what we've always done. Our book of order in our faith, in our denomination, says that the bread used for the Lord's Supper should be common to the culture of the congregation. And so whatever you have today will suffice. Our book of order also says that the bread and cup are shared in the manner most appropriate to the occasion. So in this occasion, sheltering at home in the middle of a worldwide pandemic, we'll share bread and cup in a manner most appropriate, and that's in our homes. Paul says on several occasions, give my greetings to so-and-so, to Philemon and Apphia, to Nympha, Priscilla and Aquila, and the church in their house. And so today, give my greeting, our greeting, to those in the church in your house. And let's gather together at our tables and know that we're all in fellowship with one another, the Father, His Son, bound together by the Holy Spirit He sent to us.
This is the Lord's table. It's the feast of God for the people of God. All who come in faith in Jesus Christ, repentance of sin, and a sincere desire to seek reconciliation in your life and throughout the world are welcome to this table. Regardless of your age or your church affiliation, regardless of race, gender, or ethnicity, if you have gathered at this table with bread and cup, trusting in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, let us break bread together.
On the night that our Savior was betrayed, He gathered with the 12 in the upper room and He took bread. And after giving thanks, He broke it. And He said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of Christ, given for you. Take and eat.
In a similar manner, after supper had ended, Jesus took the cup, and again giving thanks, He said the most remarkable thing to His disciples. He said, "This is the cup of a new covenant, sealed by my blood, shed for the forgiveness of your sin. Take and drink from this cup in remembrance of me. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, grant us peace. Take and drink."
Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Amen.
Thank you for joining us this morning in our online service of worship. I pray that you have been blessed in your home and all in your household have been blessed as well in the celebration of communion together. A reminder to everyone that if you have any prayer requests or pastoral concerns, please feel free to contact me or Tom or any one of our elders.
And on behalf of the elders, thank you. Thank you so much for your continued support, your gifts, tithes, offerings, your givings that continue the mission and ministry of Lebanon.
If you'd like to present an offering this morning, you're fine in the drop-down description below, just below this video, information about our website where you could give online or an address in which you can send in a gift. Again, thank you for your continued support to the life of our congregation.
We'd like to conclude today with a closing hymn of praise by Mike Peterson, Jesus Paid It All.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and grant you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Watching, pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Now indeed I find thy power in thine alone can change the leper spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain.